Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the New York Historical Society. I'm Louise Mirror, New York Historical's president and CEO, and it really is a great thrill for me to see so many of you this evening in our beautiful Robert H. Smith Auditorium. We are thrilled to welcome David M. Rubenstein back to the New York Historical Society. Mr. Rubenstein is a co-founder and co-CEO of the Carlyle Group, one of the world's largest private equity firms. Mr. Rubenstein is without a doubt one of our greatest American philanthropists, committing time as well as financial resources to his many philanthropic interests. "I don't play golf," he has said, and actually I heard him say that just before outside, but I don't at all think that that is truly the explanation for the roll-up-your-sleeves energy that he applies to helping secure the well-being of our great American patrimonial as well as educational and medical institutions. We are also delighted to welcome Eric Foner back to the New York Historical Society this evening. Professor Foner is one of the country's most prominent historians. He is DeWitt Clinton Professor of History at Columbia University. He served as president of the three major professional historical organizations, the Organization of American Historians, the American Historical Association, and the Society of American Historians. He is a prolific author. He is also the recipient of numerous awards, including the Pulitzer Prize, the Bancroft Prize, and our own 2016 American History Book Prize here at New York Historical, which he won for his most recent book, Gateway to Freedom. And now please do join me in welcoming David Rubenstein and Eric Foner to our stage.
Thank you very much for coming. I grew up in Baltimore, and I went to college at Duke, and they made fun of my accent there because I had a Baltimore accent. Now, you grew up on Long Island, and did people ever make fun of your Long Island accent?
Well, not so much around New York City. It's fairly common, but yeah, people in other parts of the country sometimes find it hard to deal with, although normally they complain I speak too fast. It's not the accent. It's just I taught once at the University of South Carolina as a visitor, and after my first lecture, a young student, a woman, came up to me and said, "Professor, if you're going to talk that fast, no one here will understand you." So
I have the same problem. But okay. So let's talk about when you were growing up, you were a bit of a math nerd and a physics interested person. So you went to Columbia to major in physics. So how did you wind up as a historian?
Yeah, that's true. When I was a kid, I wanted to be an astronomer, actually, and I went to college, Columbia, and spent my first 2 years majoring in physics, math, etc. Now, I'd always been interested in history because my father, Jack Foner, and my uncle, Philip S. Foner, Phil, a very prolific historian, were both historians, and history was sort of just discussed in our home. Some people over dinner talk, I don't know, they talk about good cars or baseball or something. We used to talk about history, and so I was interested in it, but I wanted to be. What really changed me from a physics major to a history major were two things. One, this is the early 60s. The Civil Rights Revolution was reaching its peak. This was this crisis for the society, and many people wanted to kind of try to figure out where this had come from in our history, you know? Because at that time, historical writing didn't tend to emphasize slavery or race nearly as much as it does today. And so, you know, a lot of this sort of seemed to come out of the blue in the eye. And so I was interested in that. But also, it just shows you the importance of a teacher. In my junior year, I took a year-long seminar with Jim Shenton, a great teacher at Columbia, on the whole coming of the Civil War, Civil War Reconstruction. And that really hooked me. I'm still studying that time period over 50 years later. It shows you how a teacher can push you in a direction, you know, and inspire you.
So how did you manage to resist the temptation many people had in your generation to go to law school or the higher calling of private equity?
I actually applied to law school and I thought about it. I was admitted to, when I was going to go after college, I was admitted to graduate school, I was admitted to law schools, and I had to decide. I don't know, I just found law, I really wanted to study by this point, the sort of history of the anti-slavery movement.
Because have you ever thought about how much New York would be better if we had one more lawyer here?
Right.
So talk about for a moment, before we get into some of the things you've written about, your father. He was a pretty prominent historian, but what was his problem in terms of being able to teach?
Well, my father, Jack Foner, was the victim early in his career of what you might call a pre-McCarthy McCarthyism. This was in 1941 when the state legislature, he was teaching at City College, as was my uncle Philip Foner. Actually, my father was at the downtown branch, which is now Baruch, and then my uncle, and by the way, they were identical twins, which is why they were put at different campuses, because otherwise everyone would be completely confused. But they were both caught up in a legislative investigation, the Rapkuder Committee here in New York, investigating quote-unquote communist influences in the city university. As I say, this is early 41. If it had happened 6 months later, it wouldn't have happened, because when Hitler invaded the Soviet Union in June 41, Stalin became our ally, and this sort of thing stopped for a while. But I think 60 faculty were fired from the City University after being named by informants. There was a lot of controversy about exactly what they had done or not, but, you know, we were talking before, one of the charges, so to speak, against my father to show he was not trustworthy was that in his history courses he put a great deal of emphasis on African-American history, or Negro history, as it would have been called then. And that was kind of just off the mainstream and suggested he was kind of subversive in some way. But so all the time I was growing up, he was blacklisted, basically. He could not teach again until the mid-60s. So, you know, I learned something from
that. How did he support the family?
The fragility of liberty in this country.
How did you support the family then if he couldn't teach? What did he do?
Yeah.
What did he do to support the family?
My father basically earned his living giving freelance lectures around the New York area on public affairs, world affairs. My mother, who had retired as a school teacher, had a pension. We grew up in a very modest kind of, home. But anyway, my father was a very fine historian, but more to the point, I think, he never became embittered. He never let this kind of deter him from doing the kind of work he wanted to do.
All right, so you got your PhD at Columbia. And then ultimately, you decided to specialize in a number of areas, among them freedom, Civil War, Reconstruction, slavery. Let's go through some of those subjects. So talk about freedom. Our country was formed by people who wanted to escape the lack of religious freedom in, let's say, England. Mm-hmm. Why is it that when they came over here, they had the same lack of tolerance for other people who wanted to have a different religion than the one they wanted?
Well, unfortunately, this is something that we see in the world it's not particularly limited to religious groups, but if you believe you have the truth with a capital T, that may make you intolerant of other views. You're talking mostly about the Puritans, right, really, in New England, who, of course, moved in the 1630s to escape what they considered, you know, the Church of England's dominance and lack of place for them as Puritans in England. But as soon as they got here, they set up a theocracy, or tried to, in New England. But in New York, it was a little different under the Dutch, and then even under the English, and in the South, you didn't have that. So you had, you know very well, of course, you had different kinds of religious freedom or lack thereof in the different colonies.
What about when Jews came over? Was there a religious tolerance for people who were Jewish in the early days?
Not much, no, definitely not. First of all, there weren't that many Jews in the colonies, but certainly Jews in the colonial era suffered many disabilities. In some places they couldn't vote. There were limits on their economic activity. I mean, religious toleration was something that grew over time. It was not something built into the DNA of the United States from the early colonial period. It had to really develop, and it was very controversial.
Well, recently I bought a copy of the first book ever printed in the United States. It's the Bay Psalms book. And it's interesting that when the Puritans came over, they still had the Anglican prayer book. And so they said, well, we don't want the prayer book from this religion we don't want, so we want to have our own prayer book. But they wanted to go back and to translate the Bible. They went back into the Bible to make the prayers the way they wanted, but they went back and read the Hebrew Bible and translated the Hebrew Bible. So my theory was they loved the Hebrew language, but they just didn't like Jews. It was a kind of a weird combination.
Yeah, that's right. But, you know, after by the 18th century, the Puritan theocracy had pretty much disappeared, and a kind of enforced religious toleration for Protestants was in place. Roman Catholics, Jews, no, they were still way on the outside.
Talk about slavery for a moment. When Puritans came over, they didn't bring any slaves with them. When did we actually decide we needed to have slaves in this country?
Well, you know, that's, of course, debated by historians. You know, we're coming up, 1619, we're coming up to the 400th anniversary soon of the first 20 Africans, I should say, who were brought on a Dutch ship to Virginia. You know, 1619, the first slaves landed in the North American colonies, and the House of Burgesses is set up, the first sort of representative institution. So these two things sort of start at the same time. But the thing to remember about these American colonies, the 13 colonies, is that they were part of a slave-based empire. The real center of the British Empire was the Caribbean. That's where the money came from. And, you know, slavery was entrenched already. So it's not like you had to decide, are we going to have slavery or not? You were just part of a system in which slavery was a major institution. So it just was almost inevitable that slavery would begin to develop in these North American colonies.
When the Declaration of Independence was agreed to in 1776 and the Constitution in 1789, no mention of slavery is in either document. Why did they not mention slavery? It was such a common part of their life.
Well, as you know, Jefferson tried to put a critique of slavery into the Declaration, although it was an odd one because he blamed George III for it and not the Virginians themselves. South Carolina and Georgia said, I'm sorry, we're not signing if this is in there. Fast forward to the Constitution. Of course, you're right. The word slavery does not appear in the Constitution until the 13th Amendment, the act of abolishing it. But of course, the circumlocutions are there. Persons held to labor, other persons, you know, in the three-fifths clause. The institution of slavery is certainly in the Constitution, but the founders, most of them, did not want the word there. You know, many of them, even slave owners like Madison and others, kind of hoped slavery would die out, and that somehow future generations would not see in the Constitution the evidence of slavery having once existed. But unfortunately, they put protections for slavery in the Fugitive Slave Clause, the Three-Fifths Clause, allowing the slave trade from Africa to continue for another 20 years. So slavery is in there. And again, it was South Carolina and Georgia. I hate to single those two states out, but they were absolutely adamant. Without protections for slavery, we are not signing up on this Constitution.
So we had slaves, and around the time of the Revolutionary War, we had 250,000 slaves?
Half a million when Jefferson wrote, right. And probably 800,000 at the time of the Constitution.
Right, so, and we totally imported about 800,000. We had 4 million at the time of the Civil War, but they had multiplied and so forth.
That's a very important point. Our slave population was increased by natural increase, basically. Unlike Brazil, unlike the Caribbean, we didn't really need the slave trade to increase the population. So it kept growing. It didn't die out, obviously. It kept growing and growing. 4 million slaves, 1860, is by far the largest slave society in modern history. No other. British Caribbean had 800,000, Brazil a few hundred thousand. 4 million is really an astonishing number.
But about 20 million were actually imported for the Caribbean and Latin America, but they died off more rapidly. That's why they kept bringing it over, I guess, right?
Right.
So let's talk about slavery at the time of the Civil War. At the time of the Civil War, as we said, there were about roughly 4 million slaves in the United States. And what was the importance of the advent of the cotton gin to slavery? And why did that perpetuate slavery?
The cotton gin comes earlier, of course, but that was critical to the ability to market cotton. It's a fairly simple device, but it separates the seeds which are attached to the cotton bolls from the cotton itself. Otherwise, it's a laborious task to pick those seeds out one by one. by hand. But this takes place just as the Industrial Revolution is taking hold in England, which is cotton textiles, which creates an enormous demand for raw cotton, and the South happens to be sitting on a virtual monopoly of that. So as the 19th century goes along, thanks to the Industrial Revolution, thanks to the cotton gin, slavery expands enormously in the U.S. You know, that it's not tobacco anymore like in the colonial era. The cotton kingdom develops, and that's where the heart of slavery is, and it's growing, and, you know, we should not... Some people think slavery would have died out pretty soon if the Civil War hadn't taken place. No, it would not have. It was thriving. There were more slaves on the eve of the Civil War than at any other moment in our history, so it was not going anywhere.
What was the Great Migration, where you had slaves from the middle Atlantic states now going, walking, essentially, being forced to walk to the Deep South?
Well, this is, my pal Ira Berlin, excellent historian, calls it the second Middle Passage. There's the Middle Passage from Africa to the New World. The second is the transportation of maybe 2 million people over the course of 40, 50 years from the Old South, the Upper South, Virginia, you know, Maryland, et cetera, down to this thriving new cotton kingdom. Because once you cut off the African slave trade, which they did in 1808, well, where are you going to get? They need labor down there. They're now coming from the old states. And, of course, this is tremendously disruptive to families, to communities. It's a, you know, it's really a very tragic, slavery is tragic all completely, but, you know, this is something that was deeply resented by slave communities, the way they could just be broken up and sold at any point.
So in the middle part of the 1800s, a young lawyer from Illinois is elected to the Congress as a Whig party member.
In the 1840s, yeah.
1840s. The people say this man is going to be president of the United States. He's so talented, he's brilliant, he's handsome, he's got everything you need. What did they say about him?
First of all, they certainly didn't say he was handsome. Lincoln himself called himself the ugliest man in Illinois and used to tell jokes. You know, he had that story about running into a woman while he was out on the circuit who said, "You are the ugliest man I've ever seen." And Lincoln said, "Well, I'm sorry, ma'am, but what can I do about that?" And she said, "Well, you could stay indoors." Lincoln was not, nobody said Lincoln is, except for his wife, who seems to have thought he would. Nobody said this guy is going to become president. He was not a very distinguished member of Congress. He only served for one term in the House of Representatives. He was unpopular. He opposed the Mexican War very strongly, but in his district it was rather popular, and in fact he wasn't, not only wasn't he renominated, but in a sense, that was the only Whig district in Illinois, so there was, people took turns, but the Democrats won that. The Whigs lost the seat in the next election, and many people blamed Lincoln's unpopularity for that defeat. So, you know, Lincoln was a very shrewd and savvy politician and had already become an important figure in Illinois, but no, I don't think there was much in his future at that point. Right.
He goes back to practice law again in Springfield, and then he decides to run for the United States Senate against the incumbent Stephen Douglas.
He runs twice. 1854, yeah. He tries to run in but then 1858, of course, the great Lincoln-Douglas debates. So
people talk about the Lincoln-Douglas debates. Can you describe, you know, what they were? They weren't like a half-hour debate.
They were not, forget about what you saw on television last year. That was not the Lincoln-Douglas debate.
Now, how did they go? 4 hours or so?
Yeah, the first speaker spoke for an hour and a half.
No bathroom break, just keep going through.
No, maybe an hour. I think it was, the first speaker spoke for an hour, the second speaker spoke for an hour and a half, and then the first speaker got a half an hour rebuttal. So it's 3 hours altogether. And there was no moderator. There was no, journalist throwing questions at him.
No microphone.
Right. No microphone. They were both great stump orators, you know, and thousands of people came. Literally thousands of farmers and laborers and artisans. These took place in small towns, not in giant cities. People came from all over the place. They stood there. It wasn't in an auditorium or something. They stood there for 3 hours. I mean, this was a different political world. And they were debating, believe me, the level was a lot higher than the debates we saw last year.
Really? That's hard to believe.
They were debating big, big, serious problems for the country.
So they have the debates, and was it six debates, or how many did they have?
I think seven.
Seven debates. Okay, so afterwards, many people thought Lincoln was had done pretty well against Douglas. How come he didn't win the election?
Well, first of all, Lincoln, we think of Douglas as the guy who debated against Lincoln, but Lincoln became famous for debating against Douglas. Douglas was the preeminent politician of the 1850s, and to debate Douglas basically to a draw made Lincoln a national figure. This became a focus. But if Lincoln had been in Michigan, he wouldn't, and had debated, I don't know, some Democrat up there, Cass, he wouldn't have gotten the national attention. Did he win? Did he lose? He did extremely well, as Douglas, of course, also was a great debater. But at that time, the senator was chosen by the legislature, not by popular vote.
The
legislature of Illinois had been apportioned in the 1850. And since then, a lot of people had moved. The early settlers of Illinois were from the South, or from the, like Lincoln himself, his family's from Kentucky, from Virginia, Kentucky. In the 1850s, with the opening of railroads coming from east to west, large numbers of people are moving into the north of Illinois from the eastern states, from New England, et cetera. But the apportionment is not reflecting that yet. So Lincoln probably would have won the election if the legislative districts had been apportioned according to the population of 1858, but they weren't. Oh. But nonetheless, this made Lincoln a national figure and a potential presidential candidate.
They have another connection. Didn't Douglas go out with the woman that Lincoln
married? Douglas wooed Mary Lincoln, Mary Todd, and quite a few people did. She was a very popular young woman, and a very good-looking young woman, and a very intelligent young woman. I just say all this because everyone sort of admires Lincoln, but a lot of people really don't like Mary Lincoln very much. And, if you put somebody up on a pedestal, you're going to have someone else who's the kind of, the evil figure. And too many people don't appreciate Mary Lincoln. She was, believe me, if she were today, she'd have been running for president, not Hillary Clinton. I mean, she was a very shrewd, highly educated, savvy person. But at that time, there was no political role.
Women couldn't vote, so among other things, women couldn't vote.
Couldn't vote, couldn't hold office, et cetera.
So 1858, Lincoln does not get elected to the United States Senate, goes back to practice law.
Right.
And then in 1860, how does he become the nominee of the Republican Party when he had never held statewide office, barely known in the East? What happened?
He had no office in the 1850s. He had been in the legislature long before. He'd been in Congress one term. Lincoln managed, now the Republican Party, of course, was a very new institution. It had just come into existence in the mid-1850s as the political system is becoming sectionalized, and their principle was stopping the westward expansion of slavery. They were not abolitionists, but they wanted to stop slavery from spreading any further. And Lincoln was a very eloquent proponent. You know, when Obama ran, particularly the first time, people kind of compared him to Lincoln in a way. Obama played on that. They both from Illinois. Obama used Lincoln's Bible when he took the oath. But there is, a lot of this is spurious, but the one thing that is correct, I think, is both Lincoln and Obama gained national, attention through speeches. Not by being lawmakers, not because of what they did in office. It was through eloquent speeches that they became. But Lincoln was, as they say, a shrewd politician. He went to the Republican, well, he didn't go, but his supporters went to the Republican convention with him as the second choice of everybody. The leading candidates were Seward of New York, Chase of Ohio, maybe Bates of Missouri, Cameron, Pennsylvania. Lincoln was a favorite son. He was the candidate of Illinois, but he was the second choice of all these different. And so once their candidates faltered in the convention, but back then, of course, the convention actually did choose the candidate, and people didn't know when the convention met who it was going to be. But as the other candidates faltered, their votes went to Lincoln. rather than, you know, I'd rather have Lincoln than Chase. You know, I'd rather have Lincoln than Seward.
Oh, but the speech that made him so well known was given in New York. Is that right?
Well, the Cooper Union speech, which our friend Harold Holzer wrote a book about early, it made him more known in the East. You know, even though the people hadn't seen him. I mean, you know, just to heard him speak, they had read the Lincoln-Douglas debates. But when he came East in February 1860, yes, the Cooper Union address made him seem like a plausible presidential candidate. It was a serious. When that was published, it was full of footnotes. How many political addresses today have footnotes to original documents? It was all about the founding fathers and slavery, and he had done literally research in the Illinois State Library for this very intensively.
So Lincoln gets the nomination, having a lot of local people supporting him. When the convention was in Chicago, they gave tickets to his supporters.
They packed the convention with his supporters, no question, yes.
So he gets the nomination, and who's the nominee of the Democratic Party?
Well, the Democratic Party split, so there were two. There's Douglas running again as the Northern Democrat, and John C. Breckinridge running at their convention in Charleston. The Democratic Party fell apart over the slavery issue again. And then there was a fourth candidate, the Constitutional Union Party, Bell, which didn't stand for anything except keeping the country together. But since everyone was about, you know, that wasn't right. Enough for them. To,
right.
You know.
So the election's held. There's no more. They don't have presidential debates. There's no debates then, right?
No okay. Presidential debates.
So Lincoln wins.
Yes.
And when he wins, all of a sudden, seven Southern states decide to secede before he's even sworn in. Why did they secede so quickly?
Well, first of all, how did Lincoln win? He didn't get a vote in most of the Southern states. He won by carrying the North. And as everybody knows, the person who gets the most votes doesn't always win in our system. It's
really?
The Electoral College,
oh.
Right? Now, Lincoln got 40% of the vote. He got more votes than the other three, but 40% is not exactly a landslide. I mean, that's what McGovern got, you know, in 1972, or maybe Mondale against Reagan. So, but the fact is, with that 40%, it was all concentrated in the North. He carried the entire North, and because the North was more populous, you carry the North, you win the Electoral College. And so Southerners said, wait a minute, this is a breach of how the electoral system ought to work. Here's a guy who doesn't owe us anything. He has no votes in the South. But more to the point, Lincoln had spoken eloquently and powerfully against slavery. He, even though not an abolitionist, he had talked about a future where slavery would, putting it on the road of ultimate extinction. And Southerners, you know, read the South Carolina Declaration of the Causes of Secession. Slavery is not safe under an anti-slavery president. They just felt the future of slavery was being threatened by, Lincoln hadn't done anything, as you say, but the very idea that the president would be hostile to slavery was not something they could accept.
Well, was there fear that as the country grew, new states would not be allowed to have slavery, and eventually, therefore, slavery would wither on the vine?
Well, it might wither, it might not. It would not expand anymore. That's one thing. Lincoln was adamant with stopping the expansion of slavery. He said, look, we're not going to do anything about slavery in the states. We can't. The Constitution protects it. There's nothing the president can do to abolish slavery in Mississippi, but we're not letting it spread. And, of course, you're right. As that happens, the South will be a shrinking minority in the country.
Explain this. People often don't realize that the 13th Amendment, which we now have, which ultimately, after in 1865, was passed to abolish slavery, there was an earlier 13th Amendment.
Yes, there was.
President Buchanan supported, and Lincoln, in his inaugural address, supported. Can you explain what that was?
Well, there was a national convention that met in February 1861 to try to work out a deal or a compromise to head off secession and civil war. They couldn't come up to anything. But the one thing they agreed on was an amendment to the Constitution, a proposed 13th Amendment, which basically said that, and by the way, it's to be an unamendable amendment, which is a funny thing. I don't think the Constitution actually allows that, but it would be never amended, that Congress would have no power to interfere with slavery where it existed, okay? Lincoln, in his inaugural address, said, I can accept this because I don't think Congress has that power anyway. The Constitution already prevents Congress, but this would not have brought back, as you said, seven southern states had already left. This was not enough for them. They would not have come back, all right, we have an amendment, we're coming back. No, it was clear. This was the door had been closed to reconciliation.
Now, explain this. People often don't understand. There was a big abolitionist movement, or at least there was an abolition movement. Yeah. I wouldn't say it was a majority in the North. There were a lot of abolitionists, and the center of it was Boston and New York, probably. But the abolitionists, did they say we should allow blacks to be freed and have jobs equal to us? We should have them come to live in the North? What was their view of the abolitionists?
Well, abolitionists, their principle was, one of the big differences between abolitionists and Republican politicians like Lincoln is they advocated not only the immediate end of slavery, but also incorporating blacks as equal members of the society. That is the right to vote, the basic civil rights. The 14th and 15th Amendments put abolitionist doctrine into the Constitution, equal civil rights, equal voting rights. Now, did they want blacks to come up to the North? Probably not. The abolitionists were members of the society. They probably shared some of the racial prejudices of which were widespread, North and South. But they did feel that black people were Americans. That may seem obvious. They were all born here by then. But, there was a major colonization movement at the time wanting to ship them all off to Africa. The abolitionists said, no, they are Americans. They're entitled to the same basic rights as anybody else. And that's what made them really unpopular in a lot of places.
So Lincoln was not a person who said blacks and whites can live together equally.
Nope,
he never believed that. He was a big advocate of colonization.
He was up until the Emancipation Proclamation. In fact, he was on the board of directors of the Illinois Colonization Society. Lincoln felt, people find this hard to understand. The great emancipator, whether you want to call him that or not, that's fine. I don't have any problem with it. But it doesn't fit with the image of the great emancipator, to a man who believed that slaves should become free but should all leave the country for Africa or Central America. But, Lincoln believed or understood that before the Civil War, and understanding that nobody knew a Civil War was coming, if you're going to get rid of slavery, you need the cooperation of slave owners. There's no way to do it against their will. And therefore, his plan, which was the same as his idol Henry Clay, was gradual emancipation, so it didn't disrupt things right away, monetary compensation. The government will, after all, slaves are property, you're giving up property. And colonization, because the South would never accept a giant new free black population. So this was a plan for getting rid of slavery, but black people, by and large, rejected it. They said, no, we want to stay here and fight for our rights in the United States.
So he comes to Washington to give his inaugural address, and does he just kind of go in a big fanfare? How does he get into Washington,
yeah,
D.C.?
Right. He sneaks in, right, in disguise, they say.
Woman, some people say?
What?
Some people say he was disguised as a woman.
Well, he was wearing a kind of shawl over his head. I don't think he was disguised as a woman, but it was not a glorious entry into the Capitol.
Okay.
There were assassination plots. There were rumors. It was not his doing. It was Pinkerton, his bodyguard, said, look, we're going to get to Washington. You got to go through Maryland, which is a slave state. And there were all sorts of, nothing against Baltimore, where you come from, but Maryland was a slave state, and there were rumors of people, shooting at the train and all this. And so he came in secretly, the train. Nobody knew what the exact route was or the date. It was a sign of how fraught the situation was.
All right, so the Civil War breaks out. He becomes president. He's inaugurated. The Civil War breaks out. But people think, okay, we have three times as many people in the North as in the South. We have more wealth. This war will be over in a couple of weeks. So the first battle is in Bull Run, and so people go with lounge chairs from the North to watch
tourist attraction.
What happened to the tourist attraction? What happened to the Northerners watching?
Well, neither side had any real, was prepared for large-scale warfare at this time. Most of the soldiers had never fought anywhere and were ill-trained and ill-equipped. This is at the very beginning of the war. And so the Union Army marches down into Virginia, which is now, Richmond is the capital of the Confederacy, this is July 1861, and they're met by a Confederate army, and at first the Union army pushes them back, and then reinforcements come, and they push the Union back, and then everyone runs away, basically. They panic and run away, and it has no strategic importance, this battle, but it at least gets rid of the idea that this is just going to be a short, glorious war. You know, one little battle and we'll whip them and that'll be it. No, people now begin to realize, wait a minute, this is going to be a big deal.
So at that time, how many people were there in the United States?
The North had about 23 million. The South, the Confederacy had not about 9 million, but you had 3 million some odd slaves in the Confederacy.
Okay, so if you had 35 million people. Or
yeah, 33, 34.
33, all right. How many people were killed in the Civil War in combat? How many?
Well, we now think the death toll in the Civil War was about 750,000. Most of them didn't die in combat. They died from disease, but they died, and they were in the army. You know, 750,000. In other words, if you extrapolate that out to our society today of 320 million or whatever we are, that's 7.5 million dead. That's a lot. You know, this was a terrible, tragic, loss of life. Obviously.
One of the reasons some people say there was so much death, aside from the fact that, they fought for a long time, is that I don't know if this is your view as well, but in the Revolutionary War, the way you fought was you lined up and you just kind of charged and you shot somebody or you stabbed them. But right. Then the weapons had gotten so much better that you used the same techniques as the Revolutionary War, but the weapons were more lethal.
This was the first war that brought the Industrial Revolution to the battlefield. That's really why it's important in the history of warfare. The weaponry, whether it's artillery or the rifles, there was no point in charging. Actually, there was very little hand-to-hand combat in the Civil War because now these new rifles were accurate at 600 yards, 500 yards. The armies often didn't even come that close to each other. The old muskets from the Revolution, they made a lot of noise. They might frighten you, but you were not in much danger of being hit by anything. They would just, send bullets all over the place.
So the war isn't going so well from the North's point of view. The South is fighting much better than people thought. And Lincoln is under pressure to do something and to free the slaves. And people say, Horace Greeley and others in New York say, why don't you free the slaves as part of the Civil War? And what was Lincoln's response?
Well, he had a lot of different responses as the war goes along. Remember, there are four slave states that remain in the Union, the so-called border states, right? Maryland, Delaware, Missouri, and Kentucky. They're in the Union, but they have about 750,000 slaves together. And Lincoln is very afraid, at least in the first part of the war, that if he acts against slavery, they will join the Confederacy. And he says, if I lose them, the task is too great for us. It was already enormous. The Confederacy is an area as large as Western Europe. To occupy, as you said, and it's a very, if on paper, how could the South win? On paper, the North is, whether it's population, industry, finance, you name it, the North is way ahead. But wars are not fought on paper. Anybody here can think of wars where the weaker side won. And the task of the Union was far greater. The South did not have to invade and conquer the North, but the North had to invade and conquer the South. That kind of eliminated all of those great advantages of the North. So Lincoln felt, boy, if we add another four states to the Confederacy by going after slavery, we'll never be able to.
And that was his view for a long time. But then in September, I guess it was, of 1862, he issues the preliminary Emancipation Proclamation. It says he'll issue the final one on January 1 of 1863.
Right.
So what propelled him to issue an Emancipation
Well,
Proclamation?
That's a long story. You can read about it in my book on Lincoln.
Give us the Reader's Digest version.
Many things propelled him. Number one, they're not winning the war. That's the main problem. The war is a stalemate. And more people are saying, you can't win this war just as a war of army against army. You've got to go after the infrastructure of Southern society. It's slavery that is enabling them to keep these armies in the field, that is providing the materiel for the Confederate Army, that's growing the food. You've got to undermine the society, not just the army. But also, you need more manpower. Up to that point, as you know, they didn't let blacks in the army, but at this point, you need every man you can get, and emancipation might lead to a large influx of black soldiers. There's the question of Britain and whether it might intervene on the side of the Confederacy, and making it a war about slavery, not just the Union, would make it difficult for Britain to do that. So there's all sorts of reasons, and there's this rising anti-slavery sentiment in the North, a growing sentiment, slavery is the cause of this war, and if we don't act against it, we will never be able to solve this fundamental problem in our society. So yes, the preliminary proclamation is a warning. If you guys don't stop fighting by January 1st, I'm going to free the slaves in the Confederacy. It doesn't apply to the four border states.
So Lincoln is a very eloquent speaker and writer, and the Gettysburg Address, which he later gave, was very eloquent, of course, and his second inaugural address and his first inaugural address. The Emancipation Proclamation, is that very eloquent?
No, it's pretty boring, but remember, it's a military order. Military orders are not likely to be very eloquent, right? In fact, if you read the Emancipation Proclamation, you're probably disappointed. It is not like the Declaration of Independence. It does not begin with immortal language about the rights of mankind. It is, you know, as I say, Lincoln is a lawyer, a constitutionalist. He feels the only constitutional legitimacy for this action is what he calls the war power of the president. The president is the commander-in-chief of the armed forces. This is an act, as he says, under military necessity. It is to weaken the other side. And so it's a military order. It is not he doesn't want it to be eloquent. He doesn't want it to seem as if he's just imposing his personal hatred of slavery onto the war effort. It is, people will support it. You know, the abolitionists will support it, obviously, because they hate slavery. People who don't hate slavery will support it if they are convinced it is necessary to win the war.
There are 750,000 slaves in the border states, you pointed out.
Yeah.
Are they freed by this?
No, didn't touch them. They're in the Union. This is a war measure. They're not in the war. They're on the side of the Union. There's no way of going after
them. So as soon as it happens, do the slave owners say to the slaves, well, Lincoln just freed you, go do what you want?
No, I don't think so. By the way, one thing it does do, as I said before, is it opens the army to black soldiers. And by the end of the war, something like 200,000 have fought in the Union Army, which actually makes a big impression on Lincoln, leading to, you know, his thinking about the post-war world, that they have earned the right to citizenship by fighting and dying for the nation. But no, the South condemns it. Jefferson Davis said this is a, you know, a barbaric act without... without parallel in history. What Lincoln is doing is telling the slaves to rise up and cut the throats of their masters.
So it doesn't really solve the problem, and the war goes on. And then in July of 1863, we have Gettysburg. And explain why Gettysburg is so significant. Robert E. Lee takes his troops out of Maryland, across the border into Pennsylvania. They're looking for shoes, they're looking for...
What are they? Well, you know, it's a good example. Why did he invade Pennsylvania anyway? He wasn't trying to conquer Pennsylvania. He wasn't trying to occupy Pennsylvania. It shows you that in probably any war, but certainly this war, politics and warfare are intimately connected with each other. Lee invaded the North because he wanted to strike a blow against Northern morale. He felt if he could win a major battle on Northern soil, people would sort of give up. You know, it's the will to fight, which is the essential military, military resource. It's more important than weaponry. It's more important than, population. The will to fight. When the will to fight goes, the war's over. We saw that in Vietnam. You know, the United States is far more powerful than Vietnam, but we lost the will to fight somewhere along the way, and they didn't. So Lee, some people think it was a terrible mistake on Lee's part. Lee lost far more soldiers in the two times he invaded the North, Maryland and then Pennsylvania, than he did when he was on the defensive. And he didn't have the manpower to actually, you know, make that up.
But what did he say? Well, look, Gettysburg is a nice little city. Why don't I just start a battle there? Why did he pick Gettysburg?
He didn't pick Gettysburg. The two armies just sort of almost stumbled upon each other at Gettysburg. The Army of the Potomac was sort of paralleling. Lee is moving into Pennsylvania. Meade is keeping his army between Lee and Washington, moving up along near him. And they just sort of collide at Gettysburg. Nobody planned. Nobody heard of Gettysburg.
Hey, so the first day, South does reasonably well?
They did pretty well. Although, again, I think, you know, Lee is a great general, but I think at Gettysburg he made mistake after mistake. And it, you know, cost him terribly.
The last day of the battle.
Sorry?
The last day of that
battle. Well, the last day, Pickett's charge.
Explain Pickett's charge and who Pickett was and what the charge was.
Well, after 2 days of mostly inconclusive battle with terrible casualties, Lee is kind of stuck. What's he going to do? He's in Pennsylvania. He hasn't been able to destroy the Union Army. He could go back, but then he'd have accomplished nothing. So he gambles. He throws the dice. He said, oh, I'm going to take this crack unit, General Pickett's unit of, I don't know how many men, but, you know, maybe a couple of thousand or more, and we are going to go right, we're going to attack the center of the Union line. We're going to attack them and drive them from their fortification, and they'll run away and we'll, you know, overwhelm them. And so Pickett's charge, if you've been at Gettysburg, you see the field.
Charge up the hill.
Right across, up. Well, the Union had gained the high ground. You know, Lee's giant mistake, I think, was not pulling his army around so that he was then between the Union and Washington, forced the Union army to attack him. But Pickett's charge, of course, is a disaster. The Union is fully entrenched with these rifles. Only very few of the soldiers even get to the Union line.
So Pickett's charge doesn't work. Thousands of Southerners are killed, and ultimately Lee decides he needs to retreat.
He's got to
go back to, but across the Potomac, back into the South. Does the Union general say, I got to follow him and end the war right now?
Yeah, well, Lincoln was very disappointed, but that was a myth. You could not. But, you know, these are giant armies, well over 100,000 men in each army. At the end of a giant battle like this, and Gettysburg is the biggest battle in the history of the Western Hemisphere in terms of
how many people were killed?
In terms of casualties and in terms of the number of men engaged, maybe a quarter of a million.
But in terms of people who were actually killed, there was about
4,000, 5,000.
4,000 and then.
But and many, many wounded and maimed. Both armies were totally disorganized after a battle like this. You couldn't just pick up and then follow. You know, the idea of going after Lee and having another battle and destroying his army, it looked good on paper, but it was physically
impossible. So Lee escapes across the Potomac. He's not really
faced. He gets away to fight again, and then, of course, as you know, the very same day, Vicksburg surrenders in the West, which controls the center of the Mississippi River, and now the whole Mississippi Valley is in control of the Union.
So Vicksburg is surrendered to the North, and the North is led there by a general named
General Grant.
Now, Grant was the most unusual general ever, maybe the most unusual president we ever had, in the sense that he was selling firewood on the streets of St. Louis.
He was a complete failure by the time when the war broke out.
When the war broke out, he's selling firewood because he has no way to make income. He had been kicked out of the army for alcoholism. So, but he turns out to be a great general, and he wins in Vicksburg. So what does Lincoln ultimately decide to do? Make him the
Well, he brings him east because they had never found a general. They had a whole series of them who they felt could really overmatch Lee. And, you know, Lincoln says, you know, I like this guy. He fights, you know. Lincoln is such an interesting guy. Lincoln is is not a violent man. He's not a bellicose man. But he's willing to see horrendous casualties, you know. And Grant is going to fight, but Grant will fight basically a war of attrition. He can replace his casualties and Lee can't, but that means enormous loss of life in 1864.
Comes north, he ultimately wears out and wears down.
Yeah, he wears him down.
And ultimately, in Appomattox, Lee surrenders. And the war is shortly over.
It's basically over.
Not too long after, Lincoln is giving a speech talking about what might happen to slaves, and John Wilkes Booth hears that speech. What did he hear that upset him so much?
This is a point of dispute. I'm not one of those. Yes, John Wilkes Booth hears what Lincoln's last speech. Lincoln's at the White House, April 1865. It was his last speech. He didn't know it was his last speech, right? So it's not like a final statement of his views. But Booth apparently is in the audience and says, this means, if you'll pardon the word, nigger suffrage. Supposedly, he says that.
Because Lincoln had said that educated blacks might be able to have the right
to vote. He said some blacks, educated and the soldiers, should have the right to vote.
Right.
The first time any American president had said that any black people ought to have the right to vote. Booth said that. Maybe he didn't. It comes from a much later recollection, you know. But anyway, he does say, I'm going to run him through. You know, because, you know, the original plot was to kidnap Lincoln and then hold him for ransom. I don't know what. But now he says, we're going to kill him. We can't have Negro equality. And within a few days, Lincoln is assassinated.
So at the night that Lincoln is going to go to Ford's Theater to see, I think it's American Cousin.
Our American Cousin.
Cousin. He invites Grant to come and accompany him.
Yeah.
And why did Grant...
Grant doesn't like the theater very much.
Well, but his wife didn't want to go with Mrs. Lincoln.
Yeah, well, there was the plot. You know, Seward was attacked that night, the Secretary of State. There was a plan to attack Andrew Johnson, the vice president, but that didn't materialize. But it was a large conspiracy.
All right, so Lincoln is assassinated, and therefore the person who becomes president is Andrew Johnson. Who was Andrew Johnson, and how could somebody from Tennessee, a southern state, become vice president under Lincoln?
Well, Johnson was the only senator from a seceding state to remain at his post. Johnson was a unionist, a strong believer in the Union. When the Union occupied most of Tennessee, Johnson is named military governor of Tennessee by Lincoln, and during the war. And he becomes very popular in the North. He's a kind of symbol of Southern whites who support the Union. Many Northerners, including Lincoln, exaggerated their numbers, who thought there was a vast reservoir of support for the nation in the South. Among whites, there was plenty among blacks, but not among, but nonetheless, Johnson is put on the ticket as a symbol of Republicans' desire to build support in the South. Because remember, Lincoln had no votes in the South, but when the war's over, the South is back, you're going to need to have a Republican Party in the South.
So Lincoln had a plan for Reconstruction, which was to let the Southern states come back in at what, 10% of their voters had said they would support the Constitution and eliminate slavery?
Right. Well, yeah, I think it's wrong to say, I mean, it was a plan, but we shouldn't think it's necessarily a blueprint for what he would have done after the war. Lincoln's plan of Reconstruction is a plan for winning the Civil War. You give very, very lenient offer for Southerners to come back in. If you can detach a state from the Confederacy, that's better than winning a battle. So Lincoln is trying to undermine the Confederacy with his, and also to secure emancipation, because as you said, they've got to take an oath of loyalty and they've got to accept the end of slavery. Then they're back in. But no Southern state is willing to really do that.
So Johnson says, I'll do exactly what Lincoln wanted, or did he have a different attitude on Reconstruction?
Well, Johnson says, I'm doing what Lincoln did, but Johnson is a different character than Lincoln. Johnson is a representative of the poorer whites of the South, East Tennessee, and he thinks he wants to keep the old slave-owning, what he calls the slaveocracy, the rich slave owners, out of power. So Johnson says, yeah, people can come back in, but I'm keeping out anyone who owned $20,000 worth of property before the Civil War. That's the whole planter class. Lincoln never proposed something like that. Johnson wants to open the door for what he thought were these loyal white yeomen to take over the South, Southern politics. But they don't. They don't. What they do is they elect the old slave owners back into power, to Johnson's chagrin. Johnson, though, is deeply, deeply, deeply racist. He doesn't think blacks should have any rights. They're free, fine, they should go back to work, not bother anyone. No civil rights, no right to vote, no role in government. Johnson just has a deep, visceral racism. Lincoln was not Martin Luther King Jr. He was not a complete egalitarian in a modern sense, but he didn't have this deep hatred of black people, which Johnson did. He met with Frederick Douglass, he met with others. He didn't seem to bother him.
When he met with Frederick Douglass, that was the first time a black had visited the White House in a public way.
Well, other blacks visited the White House under Lincoln also. Lincoln is the first president to meet with black people in the White House other than as slaves. There were slaves who worked in the White House.
But what he said to Douglass was, why don't you leave the country? Wasn't that his plan?
He met with other blacks. He didn't meet with Douglass about that. He met with a black delegation in 1862 about leaving the country. But by the time he met with Douglass, he's meeting with him about black soldiers, about emancipation. He respected Douglass, and Douglass respected him, even though they didn't necessarily agree on everything.
Douglass is doing a good job, isn't he?
Douglass must be around somewhere.
Right, okay. Exactly. All right, To wrap up on the Reconstruction, you've written that Reconstruction was started in 1863, ended 1877. So your point is that Reconstruction started before the war was ended.
During the war.
And 1877. But Reconstruction, in the end, was a failure, you would say, argue?
You know, it depends what you mean by Reconstruction. The effort to secure the basic rights of the 4 million former slaves, to enforce the law, to enforce the new Constitution, which is, you know, put into place in Reconstruction, that failed, obviously. It succeeded by a long period of Jim Crow, of disenfranchisement, of, you know, inequality. So that effort didn't succeed until the second Reconstruction, which is what people sometimes call the Civil Rights era. But Reconstruction is also, it didn't completely fail. It's the black church, the black community. It's a time when a new society is created in the South from the ashes of slavery. And the dream, the abolitionist dream of a country where race is no longer a dividing line between people, it's no longer a measure of what rights you have, that doesn't succeed. But, you know, there are a lot of other things do succeed or at least survive, the creation of educational systems in the South. As I say, the black church becoming the major institution in the black community, family life, which had not been, in other words, the transition from slavery to freedom takes place in Reconstruction, and that isn't reversed, right, even though all these rights are taken away later on. Reconstruction is a long, complicated story. In some ways, it's a very inspiring story. It's a time when black and white people work together in the South in a common cause of justice. It's a very depressing story. You get homegrown terrorism, the Klan and other groups, you know, working hard to just overthrow and annihilate this. Since it doesn't succeed, it leaves to future generations this problem of racial justice.
We have just a few minutes. Let me just cover three quick subjects. One that I didn't cover before. What was the Underground Railroad? It wasn't a real railroad, was it?
Well, you know, the new book by Whitehead, which won the Pulitzer Prize, fantasizes it as
a novel.
Real Underground Railroad. Another one of my books, you can certainly read about it. I mean, no, of course, it's a metaphor, but the Underground Railroad were groups of people in cities and country, some like New York, others who assisted fugitive slaves who had escaped and assisted them to find shelter and eventually to get to Canada or maybe some upstate.
What did Harriet Tubman do that was so unusual about her?
Well, Harriet Tubman is totally unusual, and I think it's very nice that she's going to be going on the $20 bill, I think. She's replacing Jackson. What is he on?
Well, he's on the 20.
You should know. You handle a lot of money. Yes, Jackson on? Whatever Jackson is on now, he's going off.
Well, if you ask the new Treasury Secretary, he says it's not completely resolved.
Oh, well, so, too bad.
Anyway, Harriet Tubman, what
a
did
lot
she
of
do
people escaped from slavery. Very, very few went back seven times, as Harriet Tubman did, into Maryland to lead out relatives, friends, groups of people. She let out maybe 80 or 90 people over time on six or seven different forays. Okay. Very dangerous, obviously, very courageous, and yet she was able to do this, and that's pretty unique. There's no other person who did that in such number. There were a few who went back once to find a wife or a child and bring them back, but seven times, that's pretty amazing.
Now, the movie Lincoln, which was written about Doris Kearns Goodwin's book, five pages of her long book, but ultimately it was about the 13th Amendment, the ratification. Why did Lincoln not support the 13th Amendment early on, and why did he eventually support it? Why was it necessary?
Yeah, I mean, that's a good point. By the way, the movie doesn't tell you that. The movie makes it seem like Lincoln originated the 13th Amendment, which he didn't. Again, it was the abolitionists who launched a petition campaign. Lincoln thought the best way to get rid of slavery was state by state. Slavery is created by state law. States can abolish it. I mean, New York abolished slavery in the early 19th century. There's nothing in the Constitution preventing that. A constitutional amendment requires three-quarters of all the states. The bar is extremely high to getting a constitutional amendment ratified, and Lincoln felt that's why his Reconstruction plan is also a plan to get the 13th Amendment ratified eventually by states in the South. But eventually he gets on board, and as the movie shows correctly, he twisted a lot of arms, let's say, to get that two-thirds majority in the House of Representatives.
I always thought it was ironic that the movie Lincoln, which was filmed in the Virginia State Capitol, which is the heart of the Confederacy, and if you look at the movie, you'll see that there's a bust of Woodrow Wilson in the movie.
Now, is that Woodrow, right? I missed that.
Because they didn't take it out of the Capitol, and of course he wasn't born at the time of them. Anyway, all right, last question, subject. You have a new career as a museum director, in terms of people who help.
Well, curator, let's curator, say, not okay. director.
So tell us what you're doing in that area.
This goes back, and this is one of the reasons I love being at this institution, because this goes back a long ways, back to the late 80s. Completely out of the blue, one day I got a call from the Chicago Historical Society, a very fine institution, saying they have a wonderful Lincoln, they had a Lincoln exhibit, which was very popular, but it wasn't really history. You know, it was like Lincoln's top hat. It was a reliquary. Here's a candle that was burned in the window of a doctor on the night Lincoln was elected. You know, I mean, stuff like that. By the way, people loved him. They said, we're getting rid of this, and we want you to come in and help us create an exhibit on Lincoln and his world, the Civil War era, coming of the Civil War. Lincoln's in it, of course, he's important, but it's not just going to be Lincoln, Lincoln, Lincoln with nothing else. I said, you got the right guy? I've never had anything to do with museums, really. I said, no, we know how to make museum exhibitions, but we want a historian to make it an up-to-date presentation. And this was quite unusual then. Now it's de rigueur for societies like this to hire a professional, you know, an academic historian when they have exhibits being created. But I thought it was very interesting. So that got me into this world of museum curating. And later in the 90s, I curated an exhibit on Reconstruction, which traveled around to 7 or 8 institutions. I worked at Gettysburg on the new visitor center, which opened a few years ago. And my most recent, I had something to do here with the exhibit on slavery in New York, which the Historical Society, 2 exhibits, wonderful exhibits, you know, 10, 15 years ago. And my most recent thing was as an advisor to the new Museum of African American, history and culture, and wonderful museum. And I worked with Lonnie Bunch very closely on that. I knew him from when he was head of the Chicago Historical Society. So I think, my main point, I know we have to end now, but is I believe that historians like me and others should be there wherever history is being presented. We should not stay in our ivory tower. We should be out there helping to make history good history, up-to-date history, whether it's in a historical society, a museum, a battlefield, you name it. And I've tried to do that really over the last 20 so odd years since that Chicago exhibit.
You mentioned the African American History and Culture Museum. Let me just close on that. That is a part of the Smithsonian, as many of you may know. And it was built, it took 13 years to build it. It had $270 million in the federal government, $270 million raised by the private sector. It opened on September the 24th of last year. President Obama opened it. And since that time, more than 1 million people have gone to it. And we anticipated at the Smithsonian that the average person would take 1.5 hours to go tour it. The average person is taking 6.5 hours. And so I highly recommend it. I can say that as a chairman of the Smithsonian, I gave a tour to the President of the United States with Lonnie Bunch recently.
Yes, I heard about that from Lonnie.
Quite something. But anyway, I'd say I highly recommend it.
Is this correct? Maybe I'm going out of school. Is it correct that when he got to the Dutch and the slave trade, he said, I'm very popular in Holland. They like me over there. I've got a good hotel. You don't have to answer that.
I better just talk about the museum. But I would say it was a very good tour, and I highly recommend it for all of you. It's not really for African Americans. It's for all Americans.
Oh, absolutely.
And really, I think it's a life-changing experience when you go through this. It's an extraordinary museum, and I think one of the best museums in the United States. So
Eric, I will second that, absolutely. But the only thing you didn't mention is you got to book your ticket a long time in advance because it's so popular.
It is. It takes
time.
So
do that. If you know you're going to Washington, get online and get a ticket to the Museum of African American History.
Eric, thank you for an interesting evening.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.